A lot of people calling it the best TV series ever.
The injuries that they have, it is just the slowest, most painful death I've seen. When she woke up and took her makeup off, I just literally thought, like, who the fuck is that? I could not believe the amount of work that she must have had done. For every penny or pound that she's got in her bank account, there's a drop of sperm spilled. But it's only sticking my face in pizza. Do you know what I could do with 100 grand or something?
What if they told you men will not do it?
But I think he's the most overrated artist of the last 30 years. I'm like, he's getting emotional here. What's going on? And he's like, oh, my brother loved you. Mm. And I thought, oh, fuck. His brother's dead. Mm. Most YouTubers are just completely acting. Welcome back to the True Geordie podcast.
Quite formal. Available on iTunes and Spotify if you must.
Subscribe on iTunes if you want to support us. People have been asking for this for a while. I've been trying to set up podcasts, Lawrence. How do we do this again?
Wow.
It's been a while.
It's literally been a while. I'd hate if you were saying to me the other day, I'd love if we went deep sea diving together or just, you know, scuba diving. And I'm sort of worried because if you can barely operate a microphone, I'm really worried what would happen underwater.
You know I can barely operate. I'm not a professional.
When you look at me underwater and go, and I go, why haven't we podcasted, Brian?
I've been trying to set up podcasts with guests. They've just kept falling through. So I'm now on the lookout for a guest booker who can actually help us book guests.
What happened to the last guy we had?
We've had a few who've tried. Many tried, many died. They didn't actually die.
Yeah.
Just metaphorically. So yeah, they're deciding what we talk about. I just put it out on Twitter, Instagram.
We must have had so many.
A lot, yeah. Not as many sort of boob pics as I'd hoped for. Mainly topics.
Right.
It's annoying. In all seriousness.
These jubblies.
Chernobyl. Was one of the main ones.
The best.
So if you want to know what we're going to talk about, I'll just put it in the description afterwards. But yeah.
Sure. Flick to the time codes.
I can't be honest with that. I'll just put a rough description.
The best, a lot of people calling it the best TV series ever.
For those who don't know, it's about a nuclear plant explosion in Ukraine.
Chernobyl.
It really happened, 1986, so they recreated it all on HBO, almost to the sentence of what some of the people who were there actually said. Spoiler alert, what happened? I mean, it's history.
Yeah, so, that's going to be a real problem.
Spoiler alert,
you.
Hitler lost.
Yeah, so shot himself in the fucking nuts and then in the head.
Didn't. Got away to Argentina. Conspiracy.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Wow.
Had lots of babies, apparently. Anyway.
They're not evil.
Spoiler alert.
Skipped a generation.
I think it was reactor number 4 blew up after they were fucking around with it, and they really they seemed so primitive to be fucking around with such advanced shit.
That was the other side of it, is how humans to me are fucking morons.
Yeah.
And how we are using
technology. Well, one of them in particular, one of the guys who was the plant lab guy, the main scientist, he was pushing for a promotion. So he, very Titanic-esque, let's stretch her legs.
Yeah.
He wanted to show off a bit, and he showed off just what a twat he was, and then blamed it on everyone else. And still to the day he died, never took responsibility for what he did. It wasn't his full responsibility. There was faulty equipment, but he was a dick. And as a result, what happens was the nuclear power plant blows up. And in 86, in the middle of fucking nowhere, these poor people surrounded, but they were not warned of what the damages and dangers would be living so close to something like this if it went off.
Well, I think that overall with nuclear power, we often just go, it won't go wrong. It won't go wrong.
That was their whole, and I mean, they had a safety shutdown, so but it did go wrong because that was fucked as well. When it went wrong, the main things I took from the show, in HBO, you think glamour, you think the sexy costumes, they have fucking Daenerys dress up.
Yeah.
This is very real.
Because when I first started, I thought, who's going to pork who?
Yeah, well, yeah, but it's very real, isn't it? They've got the clothing down of that part of Europe for that era perfectly. Yeah. And the poor firemen turn up on the scene. And
so harrowing.
Yeah, very. You described it as a panic attack when we talked about it the first time. And
the whole first episode is one long panic attack.
Yeah, it is like that. And when the firemen turn up, they've obviously got gloves on. They're used to dealing with fires. They think the building's on fire.
They think the roof.
Yeah, they don't think that anything's majorly unusual as opposed to their normal everyday day-to-day work.
Let the motherfucker burn.
The roof is on. So the fucking blocks are on the floor from the nuclear reactor. It's waste.
It's graphite.
Graphite.
Yeah, it's the graphite that contains the waste.
So graphite looks like stone or whatever to them. So they pick it up. They're like, what's going on here? Put it down. And then before you know it, this guy's hand is just dissolving.
Melting.
Because, you know, radiation goes through clothes. You can't. They would need very, very special things to wear. And they didn't have anything like that at that point.
Yeah.
And then that same fireman, his story is a really interesting one because it's all true. He goes into the hospital. His pregnant girlfriend follows him in. And you see probably, I mean, there's some powerful TV out there, but some of the most powerful TV I've ever seen because the guys, the injuries that they have, it is just the slowest, most painful death I've seen. I listened to the director's podcast. They didn't want to, like, humiliate the guys who suffered such horrible, painful deaths, but they wanted to accurately depict it. So they stopped short of as far as they could have gone.
Yeah.
And that makes you wonder, like, oh, fuck me, that shows how bad it was. Because even how far they took it, the guy's skin is just bubbling with this radiation and
severely burned.
It's burned in a different way though. It's like the bodies of these guys, they're alive, but their bodies look like pizza. Like it's just boiling.
That is what I was wondering: is how is he still alive? How is that person laying in the bed?
At the very basic level, the brain is still alive and the heart is still beating, but everything else is decaying on him. So his body is dying, but with him in it. So a normal person, it looked like anyway, because their face, their nostrils and their mouths are all blackened and they're corroding so badly. Sorry, you probably didn't expect this in a podcast, but they are. And they're dead, but they're alive for like 2 weeks after they would have died. Almost.
They're basically witnessing their own death, but very, 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 very slowly. Yeah. And so it really makes...
They should have been bullet in the head. Should have been killed.
A bullet or just a little injection, just something. Also because
even the injection might not have worked though because their veins were collapsing. So you couldn't give them anything for painkillers or anything.
Yeah, so you cannot cure the pain. You can't get past it. I also don't know if...
It's not like you can put them on morphine. Like a lot of people think, oh, well, they put them on a drip or that you can't get anything.
I don't know if the hospitals or the people dealing with them really knew how bad it would get.
Not at all.
Because when they first went in, these guys kind of look all right. Yeah. Like there's a day or so when they're all like, oh, yeah.
They're playing cards for like a day. It's one radiation and this is one of the two spooky things I feel about this like sort of monster in the show. Ironically, a bit like what Bird Box tried to do and having an invisible monster. But this is so... They nailed it because it is real. But
Because the difference between this and Bird Box is... Bird Box alluded to something, whereas this...
You know it.
It was a bat... You could almost... Like, you could feel the atoms like coming through the TV.
So one of the ways they... I'll get onto it in a second, but one of the ways they showed this is the particles in the air as people are breathing them in from the fire. And you're like... You're watching going... No, you're getting... Because these people stood on a bridge and watched the fire.
It's called the Bridge of Death.
Yeah.
And allegedly, all those people either died or got very severe cancer or
deformities
and stuff, after that and generations.
But you witness them breathing it in and as a viewer, you're like, knowing that this all really happened, you're like, fuck. Mm. Like, so the two scariest things are, as you're breathing this in, you don't know what's happening.
No.
And when you do realize this has happened, you don't know how long it shortened your life by, but you know it's going to have a fucking impact at some point. And then when you do start to die, you're so powerless to stop the pain.
There is no cure for this. It's just you're dead, you know? It's basically inevitable.
It's such a slow death. So there was little things that happened. So when they came in, the nurses obviously touched the guys' jackets and they were all... equally infected. They showed them taking all the fire equipment off them and putting them in the basement or whatever, and after watching YouTube videos, it's still all there to this day, all lay there, no one's touched a thing.
A lot of influencers have gone there since.
Yeah, people have gone to video it and that was pretty fascinating. But
have you seen that tweet, by the way, of all of the influencers going there now? So there's now, have you seen the pictures of some of the influencers who have gone?
So basically, is this sparking another "I went to Chernobyl" type bullshit?
But I mean, to a degree where you just think, "What is wrong with you?"
I'm just like, I think if you're a kind of YouTube channel which does exploration,
yeah,
then fair enough. But if you're just going to sort of make a marketing thing off of people dying,
say like that.
Lawrence has just showed me a girl who seems to be wearing sort of a medical
overalls,
taking them off down to her bottom.
And then there's someone just hanging out on the bus, you know, just chilling on the bus. There I am with my
radiation meter,
whatever.
So it's a fucking amazing program, and you basically witness them try to prove that the USSR are indirectly or directly involved in why this happened, and because obviously the Soviet Union just wanted to blame it on the scientists and put that in a box. It's all their fault.
But that was the other interesting side of it, is the politics of it, and how, and I think that's what it was the inevitability of death and how that is a bad guy in it. So it felt a bit like a thriller in that. You knew that these people were going to die, but it's a bit like, you know, in Scream where he pops out. It's like, you don't know when it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So there's points where you're thinking that someone coughs or, you know, something like that. And then the other side of it is when you are given life and death and you are told you will die if you don't break the structure you're in, but you're then given the structure of the Soviet Union, which is like the most powerful, deadly, these guys don't give a fuck, they'll do whatever to preserve their power. You have to break this structure in order to stay alive.
And ironically, the only way to break that structure is for people to sacrifice their lives so that the eventual winners can have their moment. So some of these people that you're shown who sacrificed their lives, I'd say there was at one point the power plant is in a place where they've got water underneath it, and the heat is traveling down towards them.
The heat of the reactor
is sort of like melting down. And the minute that the heat hits the water underneath, you'd have a reaction where it vaporizes and it explodes. Now the problem is they've got three other reactors that are continuously working and powering Kiev. They can't shut them down because otherwise the whole of Kiev is fucked.
Come on, guys, keep the reactors
going. So you have to sort of run that risk of, we need this running, but also if it hits the water, then all of the reactors go up. And if that happens, basically the whole of Europe is going to be infected at that point.
So half of Europe, and then the rest of it is just like it'll just drift out, basically.
But the immediate impact, will be a 200-mile radius, they said that would be like Hiroshima.
All the way down to the Red Sea.
Goodbye.
Yeah. And that was worrying.
So you've got that situation. So what they needed was three guys who were not divers or anything like that, but scientists who knew the power plant, to get kitted up in diving gear, sacrifice their lives, likely to not live after a week of doing this, to drain the water from underneath. And you see them going in, and they've got their flashlights. Yeah. And these guys aren't fucking professional divers. They don't know what the fuck they're doing. They're in diving gear. It's pitch black. The flashlights go out because of the radiation. It's like a horror movie. They're shitting themselves. And even me, like I've dived in black water before. It takes some nuts, that, let alone when you think, I've got to save the world.
Yeah.
I can't even imagine that. And these guys did it. They sacrificed their lives. Or they thought at the time. They actually, I think, lived.
I think two of them lived.
Oh, yeah. So
the third one must have been like, what the fuck?
No, he survived quite a while after. Yeah. But the point was, it was these things that you're watching, knowing that real people with real names, like they give you all that information, did this.
But
you've got people who, the miners, who had to dig a hole to try and
get under and between, so they'd stop the flow of the radiation.
So they wanted
down
to put a cooling system underneath, and they had to dig 100 meters by hand to basically do that. And these guys just sacrificed their lives, and as you're witnessing them, just go through this. It's very mind-blowing to know real people did it, because you're constantly having to remind yourself, like, this isn't just a drama. This all fucking happened.
This isn't the Marvel Universe.
So they go to the guys, the military guys, who are telling them, you've got to do this. And they're like, can we get some fans? Like, cool this the fuck down. They're like, nah, that's just going to blow dust up and basically you're all going to breathe more radiation. And he's like, mate, we're fucking 70 meters down.
We're a little bit fucked already. Yeah.
What do you think we're breathing in down there? Fucking fresh air.
I do enjoy that.
So then they all come out of the pit, bollock naked. And it's such like a comedic moment, but also like they're a bunch of Stone Cold Steve Austin type characters, aren't they? Like hard, badass dudes just getting on with the job, giving their life, and they do it without a fuss at all. They're just like, give us some cigarettes, pal.
It's again like a real juxtaposition of these guys who are in government to the point of these people who they rely on, the working class people or the people who are lower down in the system, to save them. And it really juxtaposes
all of the powerful, brainy people who got themselves there. They're like, right, all the people we've been shitting on, can you now save us, please?
Yeah.
And another one problem that they have, so they lie to the rest of the world about how bad the radiation is. They tell the rest of the world, you know, oh, it's 3.4 on the scale. And then they're like, what does your scale go up to?
I think 3.4.
It's like, all right, it's probably more than 3.4. Oh, about 1,000 times more, yeah.
I think, yeah.
So Germany sends over this fucking robot to put on the roof to clear the graphite that's up there. And they put the robot on and it just goes, meow.
Just to say, so it's fucking part of dead. It is, I can't remember whether in the series it's West Germany or East Germany. Uh-huh. I think it may come from West Germany, which in this scenario is like, humiliating for these guys, because it's like, we have to go to the opposition
to cry uncle because you're fucked.
And then
that doesn't work, and then they go, all right, well, we've got to try. What was he says
bionic robots,
and the guy goes, sorry, what?
And he's like, humans, we're gonna send some humans.
So we're gonna get 3,000 people to go on the fucking roof, and just to be sure they're gonna be all right, we'll only let you shift graphite by hand for 90 seconds each.
I found that really bizarre, because I thought, well, the funny thing is, you know, Jared Harris's character, I can't remember what his name is, but the lead scientist, or the guy who knows most about reactors, was saying, we're going to die anyway. So there's a very poignant
scene. You might as well just do it all fucking day, pal.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, you're going to die. And then when he goes out there, they're running out on the roof, they've got the spades, and they're sort of, you know, toddling around the spades. One guy kicks, I guess, a piece of graphite or a piece of...
cuts his boot open.
He looks down and he's like, cut the boot open. And you think, no, mate, you're already... The boot...
You don't understand me. The boot wasn't protecting you from shit, bitch.
Yeah.
You are dead.
The boot is just a normal shoe. All right? This isn't a super boot.
I drew on it with lead last night.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah, you're going to need a little more.
Nah, these poor guys. So they gave their lives. So have you seen Chernobyl now, though? They thought that you would not be able to survive near the radiation, but the animals are adapting, and even animals that could have gone extinct are living there now. And there's like
a wolf with three eyes,
bears, wolves, horses. They're all fine. They're all living right near the worst. Mm. No, but they're breeding. They're healthy. They're doing good.
Healthy.
I mean,
yeah, as healthy as you can.
One of them, the fish have got three eyes, and they're called Blinky. Yeah. But apart from that, it's
weird
fine.
That the fish can name themselves as well. But fair play,
Blinky.
I do think it is a little
Blinky and Pinchy.
I do wonder how radioactive it is still around there, but it's a world health.
Literally, I seen a guy hold the meter up,
yeah,
and he's like, right, that's us now, just at, like, you know, head height, and then he just puts it near the ground. It's beep 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 beep.
Yeah,
I'm like, oh, fuck.
So your feet are getting cancer.
You have to go in. They scan you. You come out, and if you test positive, you're not going back. They're going to keep a hold of you.
They take the iodine tablets, don't
they? Yeah, they do all that shit, but you could still be fucked just off going to visit there. Born near Chernobyl.
It explains so much.
500 kilometres. That's not that near, really.
That's like me being born in Glasgow and saying that
I was born near Ibiza.
Yeah.
My repetitive question throughout the show was, what would I have done? Or when these guys are presented with, you have to go and sacrifice your life, and it might not even be to save the world. Like, we might fail, or a lot of the scenarios, like the miners, for example, we might need you to insert a cooling system, so we need you to do this, sacrifice your life, and this might not even be needed.
Nitrogen you can get.
I mean, they were told they were needed, but regardless, my thing was, if this happened now, all the snowflakes and pussies, they wouldn't band together like this lot did. They wouldn't stand up and say, I'll fucking do this. People would just bolt, especially in London. Not a fucking chance.
Do you think... I mean, I see what you're saying. I see there's a bit more of a complex mentality now in modern
society. No, there's
society.
There's an individualist... the community mentality is almost dead in our society.
Weirdly, this show is about how the Soviet Union created the problem, but the Soviet Union also solved the problem. So... How did it work? How does that come off? Because at that point, it was coming towards the end of the Soviet Union.
It's not about the Soviet Union for me. It's about that era. It's about the 80s. It's about back in the day, before social media and all that shit, people were different. And, totally. And especially in that part of the world, they were hard people.
Do you ever wonder, though, if that, something like that did happen, does social media affect you to such a degree that maybe the government would take charge of social media? Or if martial law came in, does Twitter just get shut down?
Well, I've got no doubt they've got that kind of capability. But in the start of the beginning of the show, when they realise it's going to tits, they stand up and they go, let's just cut the power, cut the telephone cables, let's make sure no one can tell anyone.
Yeah.
And
genius.
We're going to keep this all in-house and the USSR are going to love us. We're going to be rewarded for this one day. No one will ever know what happened.
Weirdly, says we'll get the afterglow. You're like, you will glow later. Yes.
Yeah, green motherfucker.
Every little bit of you. That was quite a sad moment as well when the fireman is buried. That was a really poignant moment for me.
They weld him inside of a metal coffin. They lower it into a mass grave where other guys who were infected, probably other firemen and scientists, and they pour concrete into the grave.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like...
It's not a happy...
You're hardly singing Candle in the Wind. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's really not a nice burial.
Elton John would go nowhere near
Pripyat. It does make you like sort of want to Google where the local power plant is.
There was that leak, wasn't there? In one of the nuclear power stations
in the UK. Glasgow?
Around there. I can't remember exactly where it is.
So basically there was cracks in the core. And it's still running. It's going to be up and running again. They're repairing it.
Papier-mâché.
Plasters all of that.
Yeah.
Be fine.
Yeah.
It doesn't make you, like, I just worry because, like, in all walks of life, we know people phoning it in. I mean, we've got Cron. Right. I mean, you know, we've got, there's a lot of, what?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Kind of struggling every day with all the radiation that comes off.
But in nuclear power plants, you can't just turn up and go, bit tired today.
You can't Homer Simpson it.
I'm just going to, ironically,
yeah.
You can't. And you can't just sort of get by. You have to know what the fuck you're doing.
Yeah.
And up in Glasgow. I've worked up in Glasgow before. That worries me. I hope not everyone there is from Glasgow. I love Glasgow.
Right.
Don't get me wrong. Had some fucking good memories up there.
Yeah.
Great time. Great nightlife. That's what worries me.
Right.
Too much of a good time.
Yeah.
Stay sober.
A guy on the street the other day who said 5G is going to kill us all.
Is he a fan of the pod?
He had seen a couple of episodes which worried me.
Right.
And I sort of thought, are these the kind of wackos that we... So I just...
Generally, no. They're usually about 20-year-old lads. I've met a lot of them.
This guy was minimum 45.
Okay.
So I'd stepped out of Birmingham New Street Station. I was on my way to a meeting. Sure. I picked up a coffee and I was walking down the street and out of nowhere, the corner of my eye... just catch a sign and it says 9/11 was an inside job and so were the rest of them. And I was like, the rest of the jobs. So I walked over and I was a little skeptical, but I wanted to keep an open mind.
Why did you walk over? Because when you say that, and don't get me wrong, I've got my skepticism about 9/11, but you stay away from people on street corners shouting about it.
He didn't shout. That was the weird thing.
And making signs about it.
So there was a tiny little 9/11 sign. The rest were about the 5G in the UK. And he was saying, 5G technology.
I love that. He's like, should we go big on 5G or big on 9/11?
Well, the thing is,
9/11, old news. 5G, current.
9/11 brings you over.
He's a YouTube title master and he doesn't even know at the start.
Come for the 9/11, stay for the 5G, you know?
He hooks you in.
He noticed I was interested and I wanted to ask him a few questions. I said to him, there's no animosity, I just want to know what you're saying. And he said, he looked a bit nervous, like at any point I could have thrown a milkshake on him. And so this guy said to me, look, like, you know, we even have false flagging in the UK. And I was like, we do? And he said, come on, man.
7/7, was he saying?
7/7 was a big one. The Manchester bombings, he said to me, were a big one. And that triggered something
in
me.
It will do, because you knew someone who was there.
Well, I had a member of my family.
Yeah.
And I said to him, he said...
You've never told that story, really, have you?
Yeah, I don't know the member that well.
You're not a close relative, but still, it's a big deal, isn't it?
It's a big deal when you hear it, when someone says, you know, your great auntie's son is, you know, in hospital with severe burns after being caught up in the Manchester bombing. And he said, they're all actors. I said,
fuck me. Mm. This is what happens when one of those mentalists comes up against someone who actually knows someone.
Well, but, and I, yeah, that, and I,
you're like, really?
And I went,
you must get really? An Academy Award, me uncle.
And I said, that's really interesting. I said, so are you saying my uncle is an actor because he's been in hospital for 9 months? I'm just curious because I want to know if he's lying or not.
9 months in hospital, you said that.
And he said to me,
but you were talking to a mentally ill
but he
guy.
Didn't have any answers is what I'm saying.
Of course not.
If I was if I had such conviction, what's I'd have
your
gone,
uncle's name?
Yes, your uncle. I'm not going to say on the
body
podcast.
Dumble. Body dumble.
Exactly.
He's being transported. He's on an island.
Yeah.
And there's another guy in hospital.
And that's the worry for me is that I felt a bit sorry
island.
For him.
Yeah.
And then he really looked nervous. Oh. And then I went, do you mind if I take this paper? Fold that up. I'll be going now.
Oh my God. Were you wearing like black at the time? Like, he thought you were a government shill.
All black.
A government shill.
The reflective sunglasses.
Oh, mate. All of a sudden, boom.
Yeah.
Here come the men in black. Galaxy Defend.
Why didn't we get a brand deal for Men in Black? Because Men in Black is a film I love.
Is it coming back?
Yeah. And they gave it to the fucking dickheads from Love Island.
Well, it's Love Island, mate.
Yeah, no, but I mean, realistically, I did see someone from Love Island the other day. I was like, when you're promoting men's things, it tends not to go down so well. But funny, when you promote women's things, they tend to like it. Why are they sending you to all these big events?
I don't know. We get fucked over for stuff like this because they don't want people who've built an audience. They just want TV twats.
They don't want the man to get up.
What do you think of Love Island? Genuine. Because this is one of the other TV shows we've been asked to talk about.
I felt bad.
Since we did the first... So we did a little bit of the contestants going in.
Sure, we did 2 minutes. It went viral, more viral than any other YouTubers ever had, whatever.
And the cocks who clip your stuff up and put it on Twitter and
you're
Instagram.
So bitter about that. Why? 20,000 retweets, 40,000 likes.
They didn't credit us in any way. And it's like, the whole point is that people might want to watch what we do every week, you know?
Yeah.
But anyway, fuck it.
That's where the Loslims come in. A lot of them in the comments below when people are going, I love this, where can I find it? They were going, True Geordie.
Yeah, I rate that, fair play. But it's just... you know, disappointing. But anyway, we've had people come and say we need to talk about it. I've watched like 1.5 episodes.
I've tried and watched 2.
It's mindless bullshit. And if you think it's anything better than that, then probably not the type of person I'd want to have a long chat with. Do you know what I mean?
So it's like,
if you enjoy it for mindless bullshit, that's cool.
Cool.
But it is just, it's just a dross in it.
Yeah. And then the other side to it is I felt guilty after I'd eviscerated that girl for
no,
being
everyone
a,
said you got a spot on, mate.
Well, the thing is, I watched since and she seems nice, but maybe I am sort of susceptible to assholes kind of taking you in and being nice temporarily and then in the long run being
there was
an
one
asshole.
Girl on there, and I'm not going to name her.
Right.
Because I don't want to...
Also, you don't know her name.
I don't want to... I definitely don't know her name. You've nailed me on that.
I don't want to name her. Why? I don't know how to name her.
This is the thing, right? I might be coming across as a bit of a cunt. I don't mean it. But we're fucking here to talk about what's going on.
Listen, mate.
This
at the end of the day...
This girl... She woke... The night before, she looked like... What? Decent looking girl.
Oh, God.
When she woke up and took her makeup off, I just literally thought, like, who the fuck is that? Like, I could not believe the amount of work that she must have had done, like, the amount of makeup it must take. Like, I'm just like, if you look that different without makeup, this ain't worth it. Like, you need to scale it back because it's such a drop-off. it's a cliff.
Right.
Of Dover.
Right.
Drop off.
Sure, she's got white teeth, whatever.
The night before, I don't look like a 10, and then the day after, a 4.
You're
like,
always a 6.
I'm not. Yeah, I'll take that. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. But it's a joke.
Makeup's always existed.
Oh, makeup. Yeah, and I think that there's a nice way to use it to accentuate a little bit. And,
right.
And, you know, make yourself feel a bit. Maybe you're having a bad skin day, you want to cover up some spots. Or that's great. I think women can do what the fuck they want. But I just think if you're using it to an excessive point where you're going to go home with a guy.
I see what you're saying.
He's going to fuck you. And then in the morning, he's going to wake up and deeply regret it. You have like just a little bit, just, you know, look after yourself, you know.
Little on in the tube,
yeah,
just when you get into work. Morning.
Girl.
Yeah.
But then on the weekend, you might make an extra special effort. You want to look good. You're going out. You want to feel good.
Less
get
is
it.
More.
But you don't do Saturday night makeup 24/7.
I felt very guilty after we'd you know, taken that girl apart. And I thought, I felt bad because I thought...
It was mainly you.
She doesn't know she's been taken advantage of. She doesn't know these terrible things that people are saying about her. No,
they're taking advantage of people who work in jobs that they're bored in, and they think, I know, I'll go on Love Island, I'll build myself an Instagram following, and I'll just run ads on there.
And I felt guilty because I thought, I've played right into ITV's hands, which is the last thing I want to do. I hate ITV.
Yeah.
Apart from that one where you get, no likey, no lighty. That's brilliant. And sometimes Good Morning Britain, but busy.
Fuck off.
And it makes me feel just a bit sad. Like, these, why are we, like, what do we learn from it? Like, what do we get
from
it? Well,
that's what I'm saying. It's mindless shit. But sometimes, and this is the thing I've learned in life, you need...
You don't.
Non-serious stuff to take the edge off your day.
You don't.
You can't always be deep and meaningful and concentrated and focused. You need bullshit every now and then to just be like, this is mindless crap, but I just take my mind off life for a bit.
But is it taking your mind off
it? It's like having a whiskey. You know, it's not going to help you, is it? It's just going to take the edge off the day, and that's what this is.
What would it be like if we were put on Love Island?
Good.
What would happen if they went... And you know, because you know, at the end of the episode, they go, two more guys go on the island. Now, you know, outside of relationship status.
I'd fucking hate it. I'd fucking hate it.
Yeah, but you would go in and there'd be, and it would be lots of this like, oh, you're right, big man, good to see you. How you doing, eh? Yeah, he's just a sound lad. He's a sound Newcastle lad. You know what those lads from Newcastle are like? They're just so sound. They're so sound. And then after a day when you've taken three of their girls, they're like, Brian's really upset me with the way that he's been acting over the last few days. Like, I've really not liked... He's fucked me over here because I had Janine and now she's with Brian.
I'm turning into an old man, like, you know what I mean? Because I hate this sort of crap.
Do you like Radio 1 anymore?
I watched another programme.
Guarantee you don't.
People want to know what we think of people like Trisha Paytas and other YouTube celebrities just getting famous.
Is she still around?
Yes. So she's recently just shoved her face into a pizza.
What flavour?
Cheese.
You see, I imagine pepperoni.
And she just sort of... Do you want to watch it real quick?
Do we have to? Has she had surgery?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, that's not sexy, is it?
There's something for these men where they eat like a pig, where the women are like pigs and disgusting, like, sort of no manners and just like, ugh, like disgusting, you know? She's just smothering her face in a big pizza pie.
Can I just say, she just turned the pizza as if she needs to do to cover understand. The whole thing.
No, absolutely. So she's a disgusting pig. Is that's her thing now?
It's quite a deep dish, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. You need it for the full face, Loz.
Yeah, but...
That's what she's doing for money. That's her moneymaker.
Shake your moneymaker. I love how she's done the hand towels before.
What is she doing? I don't get it.
I'll be honest, this sort of feels ceremonial.
It reminds me of when...
Ayahuasca.
It reminds me of when Daenerys eats the heart in Game of Thrones. Too.
Great moment.
I don't know if you've seen that.
I haven't, but I pretend I do.
You get it. You get the point.
I get
so
the
this
point.
Is what she does for money, and men obviously stroke the tip of their penis and bust nuts out over...
But does that come from a place of like deep sadness and insecurity?
Oh, I mean, if you're crying constantly on video and shit like she does, I can't... explain it any other way.
So why as a society are we sort of comfy with that? Like, why do we just sort of go, Trisha?
I think there's a trade-up, isn't there? She knows that for every penny or pound that she's got in her bank account, there's a drop of sperm spilled for that. And that is what she does. How she earns money.
I'm not saying it's wrong. And there's no judgment here. But imagine if...
There's always judgment with us. We know that.
No, but you've got to have an element of trying to size up the situation. So that inherently has judgment. But if, when she's doing a live stream, instead of being at their computers, the men are all in the same room looking at her.
And she's... I still think, providing she had the bank account and she had all the money, she'd allow them to shoot their loads on site.
I'm not saying that she would be uncomfortable. I'm saying more the sort of men would look around and go like,
well,
the fuck am I
we're
doing?
We're all in here.
Yeah.
This is weird.
Yeah. Why are we all...
just jacking off.
Jacking off at the same time. Like, God, I should go home and read a book.
Yeah.
Like...
It would be like something out of like those Japanese bukkake videos where the news reporter is sort of reading the news. Have you ever seen those ones?
No.
So there's like a news reporter, she's reading the news, and she's like, and in today's news, it's different to true news, she's like...
Clearly, although I'd imagine some people masturbate over it.
The mad thing is, right, it's how normal this is in regards to how everyone acts like it's normal.
Right.
So there's a desk here, and then there's like a set of steps. So the men sort of go up the set of steps.
Right.
So that when she's there, the dick's like eye high, and she's like, and in other news, and then next thing they just jizz all over
semen.
All over her face, right?
Okay.
Then the next one. Then the next one.
And there's stairs on both sides.
Yeah, and they're coming from both sides a lot of the time. She's getting it from every angle.
Okay.
And
weird, isn't it?
And until by the end of the news, and we're talking like half an hour sometimes or whatever.
Can I just say, is it real news? Is it real news?
I think so. I don't know the language, obviously, it's Japanese, but
she's
glazed like a Krispy Kreme donut by the end, man. She is just glossed. Do you know what I mean?
You almost have to have a certain temperament to be able to do that, don't you?
In a way, when you see how much YouTubers bitch on Twitter, it's so hard, I've been demonetized. This girl is literally...
Being demoralized.
She's doing to camera... On point, I imagine it's pitch perfect. I don't know the language, as I've said.
You're only imagining that.
Jizzed on.
I don't know.
This girl deserves a brand deal, if anyone does.
I imagine she's getting paid for it.
Make it happen.
What happens to a person's mind that lets them do that? You know? Like, so for Trisha...
The bank account. It always comes back to that, mate.
Okay.
When you're skinned... And I can't say... And I don't look down on anyone...
No.
In a desperation attempt... To get money, if a woman or man is so low or in a bad place that they're like, you know what, it's fuck it, I'm gonna use what I've got to get what I need, right? I get that, but when you get to Trisha Paytas and you're a millionaire, which she is, right?
Yeah.
And you're shoving your face into a pizza box like that, there comes a point where you're like, have you not gained a sense of? I don't need to do this anymore.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, but no, money talks.
Do you also have to make as much money as you can while you're hot? Or like, I'm not saying hot as in attractive.
Sure. Like when your moment is there, you have to keep making hay while.
So, for instance, in 20 years' time, if Trisha had say gone away for 20 years and come back and then went, I'm gonna stick my face in pizza now, people go. But you're Trisha Paytas from 20 years ago. Why would I be interested in you now?
I don't know.
Do you know what I mean by that? Like in 20 years, there may be people who come back and they go, why do I care about David Dobrik? Why do I care about any of this shit?
People have their moment. They won't care.
Yeah.
There'll be a handful of YouTubers who last the test of time. A handful.
We will see you in 20 years. But how does that work?
I'm banking on that.
But like fame sort of works that way.
Yeah.
Like that's sad. This is, you want to go over to her and go, stop.
I think people have some people plan for the future and other people just...
Stick their face in pizzas.
Absolutely.
Would you do that if someone said, I'll give you £1 million if you stick your face in this pizza?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What would you stop
at? I would
do it
for less than £1 million.
Would you?
Well, it's only sticking my face in pizza. Do you know what I could do with £100,000 or something?
What if they told you men will nut to it?
This podcast is so fucked.
If they said... There will be men out there. I mean, the weird thing is...
So, I've had a gay fella sort of message me before on Instagram.
A fella.
Lovely little fella.
Yeah.
And I've got
no doubt,
judging by the kind of pictures he posts, which were sort of big, hairy men with beards, that was his thing.
Right.
Now, I didn't reply, obviously.
He's gone to Nut City over you.
I didn't reply, but when I realised what his thing was, I was like, so... You like bears. I get it.
Right.
I get it. He's into the gay bears.
Who's your big bear?
Yeah, basically.
Did it make you feel... How did it make you feel?
Not laughed. I didn't care. Didn't
it made me feel laughed.
No, like, I just was like, this is hilarious.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Was it because you don't know if you can... Obviously, you're not gay. And I feel like I've seen some people over the last week who couldn't quite work out what being associated with being gay would be like. I think people online sometimes worry what their audience would think if they went, yeah, it's fine that gay people like me.
The Sidemen, is that what you mean?
I did watch that video and felt a little bit uncomfortable.
So I haven't seen the video. So you mentioned what happened?
Well, so the Sidemen did a video where they did Tinder,
right.
The Tinder thing. And when the man came in, none of them, weirdly, like none of them wanted to appear as sexy to him. As if it was like, well, if he finds me attractive and I look as if I'm into it, the audience will go, Mini Minter's gay, yeah. You know?
Which
we know he isn't.
No, but this is with all due respect to the Sidemen. They're younger. And
their audience are younger.
And I just think that it's obviously not a disrespect thing to anyone, but when you're a bit younger and you're not maybe used to being around many gay dudes, there's an uncomfortable sort of atmosphere sometimes where you're not sure, do I act like this? Do I act like that? Or do I offend anyone?
Yeah.
So there's that sort of, whereas I've worked with gay fellas before. So like...
On diving?
No.
Slash football.
When I was younger.
Right.
There was... When I worked in the petrol garage, I used to work in there with two gay dudes. So it was me and two gay dudes. So it was, the innuendo was non-stop.
Yeah.
And they
were morning, Brian.
They'd be like, oh, Brian, you come to the gay bars with us, they'll love you, I tell you.
I'm sure they would.
Not what I want, but thank you.
But if you went to the gay bars, that would be perfectly fine.
No, of course.
Yeah.
No, but the point is...
Just admit it.
of course. But I think for some people, like, you don't want anyone to think of you in a certain way. So, for example, if there was gay fellas out there nutting over me, I have no control over that. I can't stop that.
No.
And I'm sure that...
And we encourage you to.
I'm sure that that's probably happened before you.
Yeah.
That's how mental... We get a lot of messages, right? That's definitely happened.
There's definitely people out there who have watched the podcast and gone, I masturbated to this.
I guarantee there's at least one person, Lawrence, who's thought about me and you... Fucking them out there.
I mean, that makes me uncomfortable.
In a double team.
That makes me uncomfortable.
On them.
I just say this.
Two timing them. One up the bum, no harm done. It might have been a man, it might have been a woman. I kind of hope it was a woman. But if it was a man, I'm not mad. Fine. Do what you want. As long as we're not in the room with you, do what you like.
Right. So you say you're okay to exist in someone's mind, but the second that it happens in real life, it's a problem.
And now that brings us to Black Mirror, doesn't it?
Exactly. But yeah. Can I just say that? Oh, that's what I wanted to say.
Do what you want.
Black Mirror happened in real life for La Liga. So La Liga were using people's phones and the microphones on the phones to work out where bars were illegally streaming the games. They were using, basically going... Can we hear the commentary? Yes, we can hear the commentary. Right, that the bar they're in doesn't have license to stream the games, and they've been fined a massive amount of money for doing that.
What's this got to do with people nutting over our podcast?
What I'm saying is, when you are nutting, make sure you put tape over your camera because the government's probably watching you.
Yeah, this is true.
Does that worry you that people can... Do you tape up your... Like, for instance, this is basically a spying machine.
It is, yeah. Yeah, but fuck me, honestly, there's too much to worry about in the world, isn't it? You've just got to live your life.
Have you ever felt watched in the gym?
Mainly by other men. That was just sort of weird, isn't it?
How do they watch you? Like, well, have you ever been...
Men often want to say, what's he lifting?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, you can do that much. I wonder how much I can do. You
know how many men come over and go, there's a lot you got there, buddy. I'd probably take a plate off either end if I was you.
Never.
You know, how many of them come over and go, whoa, they're a big man?
People don't talk to me.
You should probably stop that.
No.
Like, let me spot you.
No, but in gyms I've been to, it's mainly men looking at women and men for different reasons.
Right, so they look at the women, they go, phew, and then they look at the men and they go...
Well, especially since sort of these yoga pants became sort of prerequisite to walk into a gym, apparently.
Do men wear them now?
No, but I mean, some guys, but sort of women, when they're squatting, they wear them all the time.
Okay.
Really... tight.
And do you find that distracting? Or is that something where you think, put it away?
Must admit, I'm quite sort of... I like to get serious in the gym and just be like, I've got to get this done and get out. And you don't want a woman sort of coming in front of you and bending over in front of you. Because then I'm just like, what was I doing again?
Right.
You know what I mean?
And then... And you're mid-squat.
No, I'm not like a perv. Like, don't get me wrong. I know I am. I mean, like, obviously I'm a bloke and I like women.
Bloke,
But I'm not going out of my way to fuck a girl's workout out just by like, whoa, what's she doing? But when it's like right in front of you, when you're a man, you're just like, all right,
there's an arse.
That's it then, isn't it?
But do you think it's something deep down inside you that goes, reproduce, go and get the most powerful, attractive woman you can?
I think that we're I think men are pre-programmed,
right,
to not just to that degree, but we're pre-programmed to get bored as well. I think Well, there's an old saying, and I mean it's an old saying from one of my diving mates. I don't know how old it is, but he goes, behind every good-looking woman is a man sick of shagging her. Like, it doesn't matter how good-looking you are as a woman, a man will eventually get to a point where he's like, yeah, I've been there, done that. Got it. We've done everything we can think of at this point. You get used to each other.
Right.
And it's not a bad thing, but there's a point to being a man where you can, they say, you know, why get hamburgers when you've got steak at home? Is that one of the sayings, one of the phrases where it means, why would you go with a girl who's a slut when you've got a good girl at home who's fit?
Because you found a steak burger.
But the point is though, I feel like it's men are programmed to want hamburgers and steak.
To spread their seed, basically, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I think that's part of the reason the fucking population's growing as quick as it is because it's just the way we're programmed.
Right, men also can't.
It's not my fault, it's the programming.
Right,
The bloody programming.
It's the program you want to blame. It's God, is what you're saying.
All God.
It's God's fault.
Yeah, God's plan. God's plan.
Do you...
I go off sometimes.
Do you like that song?
I think it's a very... very average.
If it wasn't Drake, you go, that's an album.
No, I think for most of Drake's hits are very average. They're okay, but I think he's the most overrated artist of the last 30 years.
30 years?
Absolutely.
The Venga Boys.
In terms of creativity, though, Drake is held up in high esteem, and I don't think he's that great of a rapper, great of a songwriter. I don't think his hooks are very catchy. I don't think any of the melodies blow me away or anything like that. But he's good. But I think because we're in such a barren wasteland of lack of talent musically, and everyone's just rehashing shit from old artists,
right?
Drake is held up in, like, Drake, you know, like you said previously, like we've had Eminem, Kanye West, and then Drake sort of took over as the guy from this generation. And he is nowhere near Eminem and Kanye.
In terms of lyrical and production.
In terms of anything. Yeah. Anything. So
you think I'd light up, though, with Jay-Z?
I think Drake's okay. I'm not having a go at him. But the way people go on about him, I'm like, you know, if you'd... Even going back... like decades upon decades, if you'd lived in any other decade and then you hear Drake, you'll just be like, ah, it's good.
Even when the sun go down, that's a good, we'll make this bitch light up. Mm. That's
okay. But do you disagree or not?
No, I was just trying to play devil's advocate, really. I like Drake, and I think one thing that Drake
everyone does, I'm not slating him.
One thing Drake is good at is changing the arc of the culture. So it's like, oh, it's okay, you can do this, you can do that.
He's an influencer. He's an, ironically, as wanky as of a word that is, he's very smart at branding and taking his career in a good direction.
Exactly, yeah.
He plays the game well. Mm-hmm. But I just mean, in terms of music, I haven't listened to an album by Drake and been blown away. And I think anyone who has, you haven't sampled what else is out there enough to be... give that opinion.
Do you ever think that you look back on Drake now? Because when Drake first came around and he had his mixtape and he had, everyone was like, oh, this shit, wow, this guy's talking about his emotions, he's talking about women so openly. And before that, it was much more like,
gangster
women are bitches, blah, 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 you know, 50 Cent. And then it came, Kanye opened up a little bit, and then Drake just went, fuck it, I'm blown apart by women and I'm never going to survive. I love you, Rihanna. Yeah. It was basically his first mixtape.
Ask a question.
It's just more, if we look back on that now, it doesn't feel, everyone's doing it now. You know, people live like an open wound now, whereas back then that was like, whoa, have you heard what this guy's doing? Like, he's changing.
He's having relationship chat on songs. I don't think there's anything new about that. Goes back to, you to me are everything, the sweetest song that I can sing.
Oh,
that,
baby.
That is better than anything Drake has ever made, ever. Like, and that is a basic love song with a great tune and everything like that. And the singing on that is better than anything Drake's ever sung, right? So there's nothing new here with Drake. Craig David did what Drake did. Craig David. It's Craig fucking David.
Hey, Drake-vid.
Did what Drake did, all right? I'm just saying it.
We're just riffing.
He's just a new and improved version of Craig fucking David.
Right,
and
Drake David.
Just quote me on that. I'm sorry. Okay. So let's just calm the fuck down. He's not that good. He's good, but he's nothing that we've never seen before. He's not Eminem. No, don't get me wrong. I'm comparing him to one of the greatest of all time. But I just don't think he should be in the same sentence as those guys.
We were talking about steak and we were talking about burgers and you were saying...
Men are pre-programmed, yeah.
So, men are pre-programmed. Does that mean that we should change the structure of society to suit that?
I think once you meet the right person, it's good to settle down. But
it's good to evolve with that person.
But I think people who... My dad, going back to my dad, I'll give him another shout out because he'll love that. He once told me something. Never settle down when you're happy. Settle down when you're ready. And they are two very different things.
Will you not be both?
He says, I've been happy plenty of times. I've only been ready once.
And when was he ready?
Probably when he was about 50.
Right, okay.
That's what I'm saying.
That's
know,
late, like, though, isn't it? That's yeah, too late. You're done
I think
then.
A lot of men out there have the same problem as me dad, maybe me included, which is, you know, you think you get in a happy spot and you think you're ready and you have to switch the dick off and switch your heart off and right. switch your head on and be like, okay, let's just listen to this for now. Mm-hmm. Can I genuinely stay in this relationship, be faithful, and is this what I want to do? And too many people bullshit themselves, women included, but men are worse for listening to their fucking dick, let's be honest.
And
I just think that, yeah, I think there needs to be a bit more of a relaxed, I think we're heading towards a more relaxed society in that it's kind of accepted because of things like Tinder.
Right.
That people are fucking a lot. Like, everyone's fucking everyone on these fucking dating sites.
It's just more overt.
It's mental. It's mental.
Right.
I'm not on dating sites, by the way, so I don't, you know, have that problem. But
okay, what would you, do you think you'd do bits, as it were, on a dating site?
I have no idea. So
I think you would. Do you think
No, but it's all about how you sell yourself, isn't it? You've got to have the fucking pictures and
well,
whatever.
Let's face it, Brian, you've got enough fucking good pictures of you. I've taken about 1,000 of them, you know? They're all
but
there.
But the thing is, well, some people keep using them on some dating sites. I keep getting messages of girls going, have I been talking to you on Tinder?
Yeah.
No.
And you go, you've been talking
One of them
to
even
you?
Said, my mum matched with you on Tinder. I thought, cheeky bastards using my pictures to chat up some fucking MILF.
To which you also reply, your mum's on Tinder.
I know, but I also think I should be entitled to see those pictures that he's been getting off of her because he used my pictures to get
like
them.
Claiming CPM almost.
Yeah, I'm like, okay, I need to take at least 50% of the nudes that he's getting off of this because right. he's using my image rights.
Okay. What's your policy on nudes? Like, do you think that they're an art form, or do you think it's just like you just go, someone should just take any photo and any photo is good? Or do you think it's like, you know, let's try and make this a little bit sexy.
I think if you're going to take them, you need to do the best with what you got.
What's your favourite nude to look at? Just to look at, like, you know, when have you seen the naked body and gone, wow, that's what God intended?
It's always from the back for me. I like a bending over picture of their arse.
Right, okay.
That's my thing.
And so what does that sort of, you know, where does that hit you?
In the dick.
Right, okay. Are you of the belief that men should also send nudes back in order to receive one?
If it's done in the right way, even though you don't really feel romantic while doing it, it can have a little bit of playfulness to it.
And in the moment, it feels romantic. It feels like, wow.
Yeah, you're just trying to flirt around with each other.
It's amazing how the brain works like that, though, isn't it? I think
Yeah, there's just a way of wording things, isn't there?
Mm.
Just as men, that I always want to go to DEFCON 4. Do you know what I mean?
Straight away.
It's like, yeah, I want to split your arse open. No, I don't say that. I don't say that.
Right.
But no, but there's
Con's just split his open.
There's real... Con's beat the toilet.
Con's been there for about
no, but
15
men,
minutes now.
Our brains go through very dirty thoughts. And I think there's a way of just... The trick is to sort of restrict yourself in how much you admit that you're thinking.
Right.
Because you don't want to ruin it for her. When she's thinking it's going to be nice and whatever.
Like, your mobile phone now is almost like your peacock's tail.
Instagram.
You can, like, spread your tail and
Instagram
go.
Instagram for people is becoming, like, I don't know. It's such bullshit, isn't it?
Instagram. I like Instagram.
I kind of hate myself for some of the pictures I've posted.
Which
like,
ones?
No, like, my pictures are, I'm happy with my pictures, but I'm just like, this isn't my life. I had a moment. It was a good moment. But generally, this isn't how I'm day to day.
They are top of my suggested. I don't know, you sometimes sit in front of cars.
No, but that was real. But I'm falling into a similar trap to what everyone else does, which is only posting the good stuff. And I do feel like there should be a balance there. Like, there's days where you just feel like utter shit.
Yeah. Just post this.
Do you know what I mean?
Just post that. Be honest with you. Just be honest with your audience, Brian.
It's not Come that. But what I mean is, there's people sending loads of nice comments like, oh, you're a boss, you're driving a Lamborghini and you look good in that suit. And
you don't tell them it's rented.
Well, the Lamborghini was rented,
yeah.
not by me.
I'm glad you're clear about that.
I didn't fucking pay a penny for it.
Yeah, thank you, Harry.
But anyway, And I just mean, like, when you have a really down day and, like, people leave those comments, you're like, who am I fucking kidding?
Yeah.
If people knew how fucking miserable I am today, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's just got to be balance, hasn't it? But how do you provide that on social media? What do you say? Because then if you put an Instagram story out and you're like, I feel like shit, fuck the world,
people start going, oh, come on, mate.
Or you get, oh, you're all right. And you're like, I don't really need that. I don't really want that. I am all right. I'm just pissed off.
Right.
So I put nothing out because I just don't want to be that guy who's whinging on social media either.
Yeah, because also,
there's people who overdo that and they're pussies. Do you know what I mean?
I think there's also a way of framing it where you can be like, not having a great day today, but tomorrow will be better. But then people go, oh, he's just doing that inspirational shit.
Yeah. And I think the problem is there's so many snowflake twats have tried that sort of, oh, live today as your last and all of that. And I think they've ruined, there's so many people trying to be real that for people like me who I feel are real and will give you what's really going on, I sort of restrict what I want to say because I don't want to A, worry people, or B, have too many people knowing what's going through my head or whatever. But then equally, I don't think I'm doing a fair job to the people who love what we do by only posting the good stuff.
So what is real? Like, is
real? Real is the roller coaster of what we go through on a daily basis. Like, there's good days, there's shit days, but Instagram is purely a highlight reel of the life, isn't it?
So I guess the reply to that is, you know, when you get to the good days,
yeah,
you're not necessarily thinking about the bad days. And you don't, on Twitter, it's almost like a chart of the good and the bad, if you were to be completely honest.
It's
you'd be
good,
like,
though.
Having
it's
a bad all day, having this, having that. That's a really unusual thing because the human brain psychologically is like really good at going, forget the bad. Don't worry about the bad. You've learned from the bad and now we move on.
I'm not like that.
Right, do you just dwell in the bad?
No, but so like when I was in the Lamborghini and we were in Monaco.
Yeah.
I had like a flashback to like hard times. Like, right. I'm like, fucking hell, look at us now.
And then that made you laugh a little bit and you felt good.
No, like not laugh, just like consider.
Right.
Just to like take a moment and be like, I remember driving this car and I remember having this job and right. I remember having to work hard for a lot of hours every day to earn in a week what I earn in a day now, and how right. lucky I am.
In 10 minutes.
And then. I take that in. I don't, because you can't, when you've had real hard times and you know what real work is and you know what it's like to be in that world, when you're in the bullshit world of YouTube and you have the easy times, I can't let that happen and not remember. I'm not an inconsiderate person. It just lets things sort of come and go. I don't do that. I obsess a bit. I carry memories around.
Right. Because so, it's perspective.
Yeah. So when I have those moments, like there was one moment I was going to sort of post about, but then I was like, I met a fan in the gym, just working out. This kid comes over to me and he's like, fucking hell, it's you. You know what I mean? Like
yeah.
the usual sort of, but then he goes, phew. And I'm like, he's getting emotional here. What's going on? And he's like, oh, my brother loved you.
Mm.
And I thought, oh, fuck. His brother's dead. And he's like, oh, he died like 3 years ago, but like he loved everything you did. And he was a huge, and he'd love that you are doing so well. And he like got really, there's times where you have a conversation with someone about someone else and you can fucking feel that emotion for that person coming through. And I could tell, like, meeting me in the gym was like him having a moment with his brother.
Yeah, bringing it all back, really.
Like, no, but it was almost like for him, and whatever you believe, but it was for him like a real refreshing moment of his brother's life. And this was something that I was the thing, but I was irrelevant. It was about him and his brother, not about me.
Yeah.
I was just the thing that brought that back.
It's like his spirit was back.
Yeah, it was like in that moment he bumps into me and he's like, oh, my brother.
Mm.
And I felt that. And he made me realise just how much I mean to some people. Not everyone, but you have those fans that are just like everything you do, they support. And we had like, I kind of hugged him. I was like, oh, fuck me. I know how it feels like when you're missing someone and you bump into someone or you hear a song. Mainly it's music for me that reminds me of people. I can't fucking get through some songs. But for me, for him, it was just me that was his brother's thing. And yeah, we had that moment and I walked out and like, I was like overcome with that feeling that he'd sort of left me with. And I could tell like he'll be thinking about it all day because I've been there when you're missing someone. So I just sat in my car and I was like, phew. And then I recorded a video for Instagram, but I never posted it because I was like, it's fucking heavy that. That's really heavy. I mean, I've said it now, but you know.
Maybe people are more in a mind space to get it. Like sometimes Instagram's sort of like you're flicking through your day and you're like, shit, what are they going through?
It was, I recorded like a 2 minute thing and I just felt like it didn't explain the feeling of what I was going through or what he'd left me with.
I guess also like there is a bit of a weird thing where if you're going through an emotion, that's what YouTube can be quite good at. I think maybe that's what commentary YouTubers are quite good at, is like, maybe not good, but they're good at distilling it and writing it in a certain way and being like, this is what this emotion means, this is what this emotion means. That's what, for me, I think sometimes when you find a good YouTuber who's good and you can relate emotionally to them, that's, it's not like a friend, but it's like something you know, that's very rare. There's not many YouTubers where I watch where I'm like, God, like, really emotionally resonate with this guy, you know?
Yeah, I sat and watched outtakes of Stephen Tries last night and just pissed myself laughing.
Yeah,
like there's few people who you just live like through that moment, like when you're watching it and laughing.
It comes through the camera through the screen. That's also what Chernobyl was like, where you could feel the emotion of those people. And I feel like there's very, sometimes you feel it, but then there's sometimes when you watch like James Charles crying, you're like, I don't feel anything. I feel nothing.
So, and that's where, so there's this thing, what is being real? What is, who's the real YouTubers? Because everyone wants to be real. Well, and it's sort of become, I hate how, as someone, I feel like I put myself across as close to who I am as possible without being 100% me, because you have to keep something back.
But to some people, it's not real.
But
that's,
they fucked
real.
That word up for us.
Yeah.
They fucking ruined it because they all want to put their brand across.
Okay.
As, I'm a real person and all this. So yeah, I'm sort of annoyed at those people for ruining it.
But
there are the needles in the haystack, the few, mind you, the few. And this is, I've had many YouTubers on my podcast. I've met a lot, and I think partly down to the fact that most YouTubers are in their early 20s and they're still forming who they're going to be when they're old. So they can't quite be fully real because they're not even fully there yet. Like for me, from 20 to 30 has been my biggest learning and growing period of my entire life. So I'm cutting them some slack. But generally, most YouTubers are just completely acting. And that's where I'm at now with YouTube. And you have to, there's a difference. And some of them will try and, if they're watching this right now, I'm not attacking YouTube because I care about YouTube. I care about YouTubers. But for me, when I'm on camera, I'll just talk a bit more. I'll fill in the gaps. I'll turn the volume up. I'll maybe say something a cheekier than I would if I was just with people that I wouldn't want to offend.
It's performative.
But I'm not a different person entirely. And so most YouTubers, they're completely different off camera.
Right.
And I'm at a point where, for that reason, I don't really knock around with them. You know?
Right.
And I'm older, but yeah.
It's kind of like, I was having a conversation with someone not long ago where some people you get in their lives and your basic agreement with them, if you're going to be friends, is like, I'm going to live your lie with you.
Absolutely. So on YouTube, it's almost a battle for likability. We need to be liked in order to make money. And it's almost politician-like.
Or very much disliked.
But politician-like it is. So in order to do that, you have to always make sure morally, in arguments or whatever, you have the upper hand, you come out on top, you play the right hand, you say the right thing. No matter if you believe it or not, it's about staying liked. And because of that, you're just, unless someone doesn't give a fuck about what people think about them, and there are a handful of those out there, I think people like PewDiePie have managed to retain that credibility because he's shown, really, win, lose, or draw, he's going to say what he thinks a lot of the time. People like that, and I'm not saying him because he's the biggest YouTuber, because I could give a fuck about that, but
He's one that everyone's going to know.
There's a couple, yeah, who out there who I think have retained that credibility because you know they're really just speaking their mind most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of them out there just don't.
And do you... I think that's part of it, isn't it? Is that not the problem, but they're painting it as if they are.
Yeah, but we know the truth. You and I both know, like, it's all just a fucking act in a game, isn't it?
And do you think that's a problem?
Or? Yeah, it's not a problem. I'm just bored of it. But I don't watch YouTube anymore. I don't fucking watch. I literally watch, like, what? One YouTube video a week? I watch a lot of podcasts, I don't really class it the same thing. Because you find podcasters, because they've got to talk for hours on end, they really can't hide the way a 10-minute YouTube video allows you to.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, you can be a different person when it's all edited and it's down to 10. But when you're constantly doing two-hour videos like us, like, you just can't hide like that.
Yeah. I think that's partly what makes me uncomfortable about when we do True News. I really enjoy doing it, but
the context is lacking because it is so shortened down and to the point.
And we turn it up a little. Like, you know, on a daily basis, I don't tend to actually have any emotions about Love Island. But when you're then in, when you create that environment.
We're given the news to react to. And even if, so win, lose, or draw, we just say it.
But that's what kind of I find difficult is that actually, and I'm not having to go at anyone specific here, but, you know, for quite a few years, I'm not saying commentary YouTubers are the problem. You can use it as a really good
No, but we do a commentary show and you've got to turn the volume up and you've got to hit the points.
But it goes the other way where, so people are real, real, real. Then they get to a point where they think, I don't want to lose this. So I have to just maintain it. And that's where you begin to lose that element of real because people begin, they go, I need to stay here, so I'm going to keep the rules that got me to the top the same, and I'm going to just preserve those rules. And it makes it a less honest, less yourself environment because you're basically going, keep it the same, and hopefully no one will notice that it's always just going to be the same. Mm-hmm. And that's what YouTube is to me right now, is everyone just preserving their status. And there's people coming around and going, you're going to get cancelled. You're cancelled next. Tick, you're cancelled next. That's quite an anxious environment to exist in for a lot of people because they're thinking, tomorrow I could lose this, or I could be in a terrible James Charles type situation, or I could be in a... I'm trying to think of someone else who got cancelled.
Nah, James Charles is a good example.
Maybe we should do a video of just the problems.
Yeah,
you've seen the title.
Come on then.
Shagging in the Park.
Go for it.
Hi. Big hello.
Sorry, there's more.
Big hello. Brian and Lawrence, you can call me by my real name. I won't. I'm going to call you Mark. I have liked this girl for a long period of time.
Cool. Come on.
And you've got to give a bit of context.
Right.
Otherwise the problems aren't real.
Sorry. I haven't done this in a while.
And have recently found out that she slept with some guy that she met in the park. The thing is, she openly tells anyone without hesitation. And I think she knows that I have strong feelings for her. But she's just stirring the pot. I know I have to move on, but I can't get past the fact that she's mentioned this in front of me. What should I do?
She's mentioning it. She wants him to wank over it.
Do you think some people like...
the public, outdoors.
Yeah. Some people like sex in public.
Yeah.
What do you do with someone like that? How do you solve that? What if she's going, I had sex in the park. Maybe we could...
Just get a balcony in it.
Right.
Sort of.
I'm a 17-year-old girl in year... And I used to be friends with these two girls. Let's call them A and B. And since I had most of my classes with A, we gradually got closer. And the other girl, B, felt left out. One day, me and A went to see a movie together. But we told B and asked her to come. Basically, they got really, really upset. They grew apart. What happens when you grow apart with friends? What do you do, Brian? Do you cut them off?
Yeah.
Oh.
Let's just leave it at that.
Are you joking?
I mean, if someone's a really, really good friend, then keep them around. But if you drift apart, that's natural. It's going to happen. You're going to go through school, college, university. You're going to have your first job. You're going to have your second job, your third job, your fifth job. You're going to meet a fuck ton of people. And eventually, at the end of that journey, you'll be left with a handful. Maybe that. I've got...
One good friend.
In terms of like my mates who I've grown up with, I've probably got five or six maybe lads who I'll text and be like, How are you doing, mate? And I haven't seen him in months, you know what I mean? And we just catch up.
Do you want to come around and play that video game I've got?
Well, no, but like, you just, I keep in touch with lads from, maybe like two lads from school, one lad from college, two lads from diving, you know, like that sort of thing. Like, not a lot.
I guess also, though, when you're young and you've never really gone out and seen the world, it feels like those people are your friends and they're your friends for life.
Yeah, I think people place too much importance on friends, to be honest. And I know right. that might sound mad, but like, you've got to place importance on you. You're going to meet new people. You're going right. to be fine. Like, you can't base your whole existence on, what are my friends doing? Like, people are worried about what clothes their friends got, what house their friends have got, what car their friends have got. Like, wish them the best and fucking work on yourself and grow as a person.
Yeah.
And the ones who grow, the ones who think like that, they're the ones who'll be happiest at the end of the journey.
Yeah, you don't want any nasty friends or controlling. Controlling friends are the worst friends.
Controlling friends, they're the ones who get the fuck out of your life.
What you want to watch for is the friends who, when you're doing well, undermine you.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It's only because...
Yeah, or the ones who go, but don't change too much. You know, you stay the same because I'm staying the same. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think that's good. But for you and I, when something good comes along, we're always going, oh, good. Yeah, you should do this.
You've got to encourage each other to evolve. And yeah.
Like, ultimately, you know, when UFC come along and want you, I'm not going to go, Brian, don't go. I'm going to go,
Dana White, show me the money.
Yeah. I'm going to go, good luck. Make sure you negotiate a good contract.
Is there room for a presenting job? I've got you.
No, but that's the thing is, I'll go, I know that Dan Hardy's better than me, ultimately.
Wonderful.
Just saying.
Well, it's been a good one. I've enjoyed doing an old school podcast. You know, if you've enjoyed this, show it the love, hit the like button and subscribe. We've got iTunes, Spotify, we've got all that.
Share it as well.
All the links are in the description. There will be clips posted on TG2
wow.
As well, probably from this. So subscribe to that if you haven't. Appreciate it. Loz,
you've got
been a good one. Oh, we do that again.
Oh, that sounded
one more,
better.
One more.
Ready?
Oh, there we go.
That's the sweet spot. That's how you know you got a real friend, because otherwise you just go, great to see you, thanks.
No, you can't be doing that.
Ashanté.
So yeah, see you later. Thanks for coming.
He's gone.
Thanks, guys.